Okay. They say you guys are from Santa Barbara, which is a rather unfamiliar name to the Japanese audience. What sort of a town is that?
It's about 100 miles. I'm getting such a weird echo. Strange.
Yeah, sorry. This is the way I've got this thing set up here.
Okay.
Yeah.
But it's a town about 100 miles or so north of Los Angeles.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know. A strange little place, kind of quiet college town, about 80,000 people on the seaside. So, I don't know. Most of, I guess there's one part of town is kind of old money Beverly Hills style, and the other part's the college town. And, there's just a lot of kind of research places there. Randy and I's fathers both worked at the university. Dean and Todd's were both kind of, Todd's was involved in engineering and stuff.
Sort of a laid-back place, not the kind of town we associate with sort of a high-tension music scene, though.
No, it's not high-tension, but there's a lot of music. I mean, I think that's probably why there is, because people are allowed to do whatever they want. So you'll see, there's a great blues scene, a great bluegrass scene, and tons of rock bands. Really supportive. I think in Los Angeles there's a lot more of a competitive vibe going on. And when you go see a show in Santa Barbara, just all the bands turn up for each other's shows. I don't know. It's really supportive.
I don't think I can recall ever having heard of a band that came from Santa Barbara per se, though.
Strawberry Alarm Clock.
Okay. I think you just answered my question.
Ugly Kid Joe?
Next question here is about how you guys originally got together. What was the bonding factor?
It was basically just something to do after school. We were all in high school, and I just kind of, the rest of them had known each other for a while, and I met them when I was a freshman. They were seniors. Just kind of did the, oh, you got a guitar? Yeah. Got drums? Yeah. Let's jam. So just got together after school and started playing.
You weren't necessarily the musical geeks at school or the musical heroes at school or anything, were you?
We were geeks, but I don't think it had anything to do with music.
Just geeks getting together to play, huh?
Just playing geeks.
Were you already fairly experienced by that time, or had you just gotten into music, or what was the situation?
I think for all of us it was kind of, well, I owned a guitar. I've taken lessons, but I always stopped. Dean was probably the only one. He'd like taken piano lessons seriously for 7 years. He was the only one who had any real ability. Todd had gone to a guitar teacher and he'd learn a couple of Boston solos. So, we weren't very proficient.
When did you first start taking on the veneer of professional musicians, and when did it start coming together?
About 10 years from now, I think.
No, but when did you first? When were you first able to put together a demo that you felt confident people could listen to without sort of squirming in their seats?
Well, we never really did a demo, per se. I mean, our first album was probably what most people would have called their demo. We did four-track stuff at home, and a friend of ours wanted a backup band on two songs, and said if we'd be his backup band for two songs, he'd pay for us to record a couple, which we thought sounded good. So we just kind of went in and did those two and had a good enough time that we borrowed like $600 from my dad and recorded 8 more. We were still all, still all in school, so none of our friends could go to clubs and see us play. And, we wanted a tape to give to them, and so we put together Bread and Circus and sold that around town to our friends. And at some point, it just found its way, like, people gave it to people and ended up in L.A., and we'd never actually mailed out, like, sent a tape to a record company. And we started getting calls back. So mean, it was weird because we hadn't really planned on. I didn't ever assume that we were good enough to do this for a living.
Mm-hmm.
So when it ended up that we were getting a record deal, we were all kind of surprised.
Mm-hmm.
And by the time that happened, we were working on a second tape, and so they ended up releasing both of those as our first two albums,
mm-hmm.
as they were,
mm-hmm.
screwing with them at all.
Huh. So it almost sort of triggered a bidding war, huh?
No, because it never got to bidding.
Uh-huh.
We had some pretty simple demands, and luckily ended up with a manager who was interested in having a career rather than making a fast buck.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, people would throw a lot of money at it, and what we were after was being able to release the first two albums and tour on them and have creative control, and we really wanted to just have low pressure.
Mm-hmm.
I think it happens a lot that people get signed, they take a lot of money, and like they have to be big.
Mm-hmm.
Doesn't matter if they're good or not, they
mm-hmm.
just have to be big right out of the ball.
Yeah.
They never get a chance to grow at all.
So you guys were more concerned with just doing your own type of thing and getting financial support to do that, huh?
Yeah. So they just, I mean, you know, we were cheap for them. So, you know, the first album came out and it sold like 20,000, which, if we had a typical deal, would have been really bad. But for the kind of deal we did, everybody was happy.
Mm-hmm.
Considered a success.
Mm-hmm.
So we just kind of treated it like we let Sony pretend they were an independent label. And kind of took that attitude with it.
Uh-huh. Sort of a question here based on a preconceived notion of what California should be like, but it says here that in spite of the fact you guys are from California, your music doesn't exactly radiate sunny California optimism.
Well, I mean, California has, you know, the Hollywood you see in movies, but it, you know, it also has Watts, and it also has, you know, it's got its share of problems as well as its share of beauty.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I mean, you can't really make a generalization about any single place.
Mm-hmm.
Even Watts.
Right.
The beauty in Watts.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So.
Well, I guess, you know, the music is more about you guys as opposed to where you live. Huh?
Yeah. I mean, and wherever anybody grows up, you're always going to have, no matter how perfect your life is, you're gonna eventually be damaged goods.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
From whatever may happen, from birth to childhood to
uh-huh.
into adulthood.
Uh-huh.
You know, there are definitely different degrees. I mean, you can go from having had all the right things happen and still having big questions about whether you're worth anything or not.
Mm-hmm.
To having been beaten all your life.
Mm-hmm.
They're different degrees of pain, but I don't think either invalidates the other.
Well, does your music
to work on?
Oh, excuse me. Does your music deal with your darker side, or how exactly does it work? There was some comment in your bio about you write lyrics as a form of therapy.
Mm-hmm. I mean, that's the best way for me to deal with an emotion directly.
Mm-hmm.
I think is to write about it,
mm-hmm.
sing a song about it.
Mm-hmm.
I have trouble just, you know, I don't know. I cry at like car commercials. It's a sad scene in movies. And so,
uh-huh.
like, you know, writing songs is the one way that I can try to feel something.
but your lyrics are maybe not quite recognizable to the uninitiated person. I mean, it seems like you deal with certain settings and scenes that mean something to you, but not necessarily to us. Is that your intention?
Well, I'd like them to be evocative, but not necessarily completely descriptive.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if it's too descriptive, it doesn't mean anything for me a little ways down.
Right.
But if it creates a mood, I can always come back to that and feel something in it.
Uh-huh. What?
So,
uh-huh.
I like to... I mean, I mean, for me, songs are like big questions.
Mm-hmm.
I don't pretend to provide any answers.
Mm-hmm.
So, they're just a way of working out whatever I'm thinking about. And the same questions pop up enough that very few songs have ended up being really obsolete for me later on.
Hmm.
Some have, but...
Have you seen this lyric book the record company here made up? The one that Sony Records made up?
Mm-mm.
Oh, they made up a big, beautiful color booklet that talks about the band and has all the lyrics to the recent album with their Japanese translations.
Huh.
And not only do they have the lyrics, but they have all the chords to the lyrics as well.
That's really cool.
No, it's amazing. I've got this here in my hand.
Wow, I wish they would send us one.
Yeah, it's beautiful. It's really nice. Now, the reason I mention this is because I really love the recent album, in spite of the fact that this is not my interview. And one of the more stunning songs, I think, is Stupid. And, you know, I had wanted to take a look at the lyrics, and, you know, I've got them here. And, you know, it doesn't really mean anything to me, but it seems like you're talking about something that happened to you that, you know, obviously made you feel...
stupid.
Yeah, stupid, or, you know, sort of astounded that, you know, you hadn't known something, and somebody's like a little comet or something. Something somebody gave away left you feeling very stupid. What exactly are you talking about?
I don't want to, like, describe exactly what the song's about.
Uh-huh.
That always makes it boring. Like,
uh-huh.
What the song's about, and that's all it'll ever be.
Right.
But, I don't know. You get in situations where you just assume something about somebody, and you find out that... You just occasionally you realize you can never make an assumption about anything.
Uh-huh.
Because you're undoubtedly going to be wrong.
Right. But then when you find out your assumption was wrong, that's when you start feeling stupid.
Well, no, and then it depends on how off-base the assumption was.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of people have been under the impression that it was about, like, my wife having an affair with a handyman.
Well, yeah, that's what obviously the second paragraph seems to say. She says she knew him once, and then, you know, you say it's frightening, I didn't expect that from you. It's blinding.
Actually, it has nothing to do with infidelity.
Huh.
But that's all I'll give away.
Okay, so you leave a lot of little hints, but you never really you want to give that much away.
Well, I mean, I've had people who said, wow, this parallels this, you know, this affair I had. I had one guy who was saying it, you know, he had a friend who was really, you know, who was kind of strung out.
Mm-hmm.
It was about that. I mean, you know, different people have come up with very concrete things about exactly what they think it was.
Mm-hmm.
And I kind of prefer that.
Yeah, so I guess you're planting a seed, and, you know, people are sort of letting that grow, and that gives the song a lot more enjoyability, I suppose.
I mean, it's weird. There's songs that, I mean, a lot of them, you know, stupid to a lot of people.
Mm-hmm.
And possibly everything I'll ever write to a lot of people and will never mean anything to them.
Mm-hmm.
But occasionally people go up, you know, we had a song called Is It For Me on the last album.
Mm-hmm.
That this guy came up with, and he said it was a story, you know, he kind of went line for line, and he had interpreted in this way that it was a story right out of his childhood. It brought back, like, this flood of memories that,
mm-hmm.
you know, it really, really surprised the hell out of me.
Hmm.
It was really cool.
Right.
I like stuff like that because I think when people interpret something in a way that's totally different than the writer did,
mm-hmm.
it's another good step between, you know, we currently have this media problem of confusing the people who write music with the music they write.
Mm-hmm.
And I kind of like the idea that things should stand on their own,
mm-hmm.
so that what I intended for it to mean had nothing to do with how it affected somebody.
Mm-hmm.
It's just the song itself that affected them.
Mm-hmm. Do you ever write, like, simple, like, love songs?
Now and then. I'm not that good at them.
Mm-hmm.
And I tend to write, I mean, there's been a few, but it's just the song itself that affected them.
Mm-hmm. Do you ever write, like, simple, like, love songs?
Now and then. I'm not that good at them.
Mm-hmm.
And I tend to write, I mean, there's been a few, but I tend to write about things I'm upset about.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes, sometimes I'll write a love song, but my love life has been, fortunately, not very upsetting for quite a long time. And so sometimes when I'm really overjoyed, I mean, I've written probably 5 or 6, but they were all very, very meant, if that makes sense.
They were very what?
They were very in the moment rather than thrown out.
Oh, I see.
I don't like just writing love songs to write love songs.
Mm-hmm. Are you very prolific then? Do you throw out a lot of the songs you write and just sort of put the cream of the crop on vinyl?
I go in spurts. I mean, there were a ton of songs written before this album came out.
Mm-hmm.
But, I don't know, I go in spurts. I've been dry for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think Terrell started me writing again. Kind of bored. It's what I'm supposed to be doing.
Mm-hmm. So, like, how many songs did you select from for this particular album?
Todd and I probably had that we were willing to play between 20 and 30 each, and then the band worked up 30, and then we recorded 16.
Mm-hmm.
So, something like that.
Mm-hmm. Was this band your guys' way of trying to get out of Santa Barbara? Did you want to use it as a vehicle to go elsewhere?
I mean, I was going to go to college. got 2 years in, but it was just something to do.
Uh-huh.
I mean, it started as something to do after school.
Mm-hmm.
Fun. We all liked music. And, you know, when the summer, I mean, we ended up getting signed the summer after what ended up being my last year of school. I was in my second year of college. I'd applied for San Francisco State. I was moving. You know, you apply at the beginning of the school year for your next school year. And so I'd applied. The year went on. We started getting calls. We recorded the next album. And we ended up the dead week, you know, the week before finals, we flew to New York with Columbia, flew back, took our finals, and then we ended up going on a tour like a month later. So, it was really accidental. And it sounds kind of strange, but I mean, we never really put ourselves out there for it.
Mm-hmm.
We got lucky enough that people came to us.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's one of the things that's hopefully kept our attitude good, is that a lot of people have to go through this, you know, long process of working really hard to get the record deal and working really hard to get people to hear them. And we really didn't think we would ever do that.
Mm-hmm.
And then it ended up happening anyway.
Mm-hmm.
And so we never had to start thinking of what other people would like or what other people would want from our music.
Uh-huh.
Made it exactly the way we wanted.
Yeah. Well, to tell you the truth, though, Glenn, I would imagine, though, we would expect you to do the opposite because you were young, you know, because you were so young and getting a record deal, that, you know, you would be rather naive and think that, well, you know, it came pretty easily. Now we've got to kind of get to work, get down to the business of pleasing people and become very self-conscious about the whole thing. But instead, you talked about allowing yourselves to nurture, the record company allowing you guys to nurture. I guess you're just a very level-headed bunch of guys then, right?
I don't know. I mean, we just want different things than some people do who do this.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, a lot of people get into this business because they're really ambitious.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to be a musician, but I really don't want to be a star.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, it's weird because I really do want people to hear my music, but I want to be anonymous.
Yeah.
I want to be able to walk down the street and go, you know, buy vegetables and not have anybody look at me at the market.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I want pretty basic things.
But aren't you in a rather, you sort of put yourself in a rather risky position, though, because, you know, fame and all of its, you know, attendant glory and MTV appearances and whatnot makes you immediately identifiable. How do you plan to prevent stardom, celebrity?
I don't know. I mean, we've, at the level we're at, pretty comfortable.
Mm-hmm.
And I hope they'll stay at this level. I mean, I think you have to put yourself in those positions. I mean, you really have to play out for it and have the extra bit of, you know, shine or veneer or whatever,
mm-hmm.
to have people be that interested in you.
Mm-hmm.
And hopefully, I think we're mundane enough that people aren't going to be that interested.
They were talking about you for a while as being, you know, the next generation's answer to REM and stuff like that. Did you ever get upset about the hype? Like, did you ever think you guys are pushing us a little bit too hard, or you're misunderstanding what we're all about?
I don't know. I don't know how hard the company pushed us.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we kind of keep out of it. I know that, at least in the States, the press was under the impression we were being hyped, and they responded by hating us.
Mm.
So, or at least ignoring us,
mm-hmm.
which has been okay, because we've done well despite that.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know, I try not to think about it too much.
Hmm.
I mean, you know, we call up and do interviews and we play places, and, you know, we kind of answer the questions and try to do a little more than a yes or no answer, but, I don't know, we don't get too involved in the machine of it, or at least we try not to.
Mm-hmm. What sort of feedback have you gotten about this particular album? Does the press like it? Does the public like it?
I've seen three reviews, and two of them were bad, and one was good. One of them said REM is, what was it, described, we may ultimately just turn out to be REM as, interpreted by Air Supply.
Huh, that's kind of a strange observation.
It's rude.
Mm-hmm.
But
well, actually, I myself have been sort of at a loss to explain, you know, your music to other people. Like, you know, who would like it? Like, for example, often when you're explaining something to somebody else, you say, well, if you like this band, you're probably going to like this one. And in your own case, I really can't think of a band that's similar enough.
I mean, it's weird, because we write kind of pop melodies.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there are people I know who only really listen to harder music,
mm-hmm.
and happen to like us too. And there are people who listen to really, really pop music,
mm-hmm.
and we're kind of the furthest out they get.
Mm-hmm.
And I kind of like that we don't have a really perfectly defined niche.
Yeah.
That, you know, that can be thrown in with other bands.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I hope that, you know, sometimes you get a hype around a band, a bunch of articles about them, as, you know, kind of the media blitzkrieg. And with us, I think either you kind of hear it and you like it, or you hear it and you hate it.
Hmm.
And hopefully that's all that ever comes into it. I kind of prefer that music is that way.
Hmm. Do you think of any other bands, like, say, contemporaries of yours that are, like, kindred spirits, that are sort of on the same wavelength as you?
I don't know. I mean, there's mostly my friends in town.
What's that?
But nobody's heard of them.
uh-huh.
I don't know. I mean, there's a few bands. It's good to see bands like Counting Crows are getting well heard. I think REM's been being true to themselves. There's just always been, you know, it's hard to say who's a kindred spirit and who's not.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of people.
Well, have you received, like, support or praise from other bands?
Not really publicly.
Mm-hmm.
But, I mean, there's, you know, we occasionally meet people who have our albums and we have their albums. That always feels really good.
Mm-hmm.
You know, play a festival or something, and you go up to them and go, I love your album. You know, yeah, I got yours.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, really? it's good to meet musicians who like it.
Yeah. I guess
I shouldn't name drop, because I have, you know, who knows who publicly liked me now for liking
it. You make it sound like a crime, Glenn. One reason I bring this up is that, you know, people consider that, like, given that you guys are still in your early 20s, you should be part of the so-called alternative nation, or you should be a lot more hip or something. But you sound like advanced artistically beyond your years.
I don't know if we're advanced artistically. I think we're not that interested in being part of a movement. I mean, the key to any movement is that it dies.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd rather keep writing songs rather than be attached to something that's eventually going to have the media and, turn on it.
Mm-hmm.
Alternative music, whatever they call it right now.
Mm-hmm.
They're currents of music that have always been around, and it's just people draw a box around it, and it gets a little more popular for a while, and everybody's expected to do that.
Mm-hmm.
I've never been good at writing really loud, angry songs. I mean, I've cranked out a couple, but in general, I tend to be a little more subtle.
Mm-hmm.
And it doesn't mean that I don't think there's a lot of great bands who are much louder.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't like that way. I never have. That's not why I write. So, I'd rather kind of do things the way I do them.
Mm-hmm.
And there's so much of it around right now.
Mm-hmm.
It's like the, it seems like the world doesn't need another loud band right now.
Mm-hmm.
Unless they're really, really damn good.
Mm-hmm.
We wouldn't be that good if we tried to do that.
Mm-hmm. Well, people do tend to, bandy around labels such as, Alternative Nation or Lollapalooza, Generation X, and, I suppose that's why you guys get sort of stuck in that rut.
Yeah, but, then again, you can't really peg us anywhere else.
Mm-hmm.
Which, it's just probably for the best.
Mm-hmm. So you're pretty much happy with the way things are going, the way you sort of carved your own individual niche, independent of, the rest of the scene.
I think it's good. I mean, it depends on my mood. There's times I get, sometimes I wish that every review was a good review, because it always hurts to see somebody who really hates it.
Mm-hmm.
But on the other hand, just plenty of music I hate. Everybody should like what I do. I don't know. It doesn't really bug me. I'm more worried about not making an ass of myself during concerts.
What are you proud of about this album in, say, comparison to the previous three? Do you feel the band has grown a lot, or are you better songwriters now, or better musicians now?
I think we play better. I think the lyrics are a little less juvenile. And it's more, it's a combination, I think, of the vibe element that was on the first two albums, because those were both just the four of us, everything live to tape, including the lead vocal. And it has a little more of the feel that the first albums have, but it's still, it sounds good now. It feels like it's, the audio is worthwhile as well, and the playing better. I don't know, it just feels like it's, the fourth album.
Mm-hmm.
A little older. Hopefully we get better.
How about your stage performance? How is that coming along?
It's rusty right now.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we figured you could either make the decision of putting on a big show or just becoming really comfortable on stage. And our music, I think if we got theatrical with it, would be entirely too pretentious. And so, we just kind of hang out and play.
Mm-hmm.
I probably talk too much. But it's, I don't know. I've never really been to one of our concerts when I was on stage. No idea what.
But it's a pretty stripped down affair, huh?
Yeah, I mean, it's really straightforward.
Mm-hmm.
We like to keep it kind of conversational. I don't like the attitude of, I don't know. I get preachy sometimes, but I do that with my friends.
Mm-hmm.
I don't like the idea of putting that big barrier up between. between the performer and the audience.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's better just to hang out.
Do you ever try to sort of consciously or subconsciously emulate any of your musical heroes, people you've appreciated on stage?
Not really. I mean, the people I appreciate most are, a lot of times, the people who are doing something really different. You know, we just played at a festival, saw Blues Traveler play.
Mm-hmm.
And Popper's just amazing.
Mm-hmm.
I love watching him up there.
Mm-hmm.
But they're doing, they're giving something out there that is so different from what we do. I tend to admire people who do something really different than I do.
Mm-hmm. Hold on just a sec. I've got like about two more questions to go, but I have to turn my tape over, okay?
Okay. All right. So when you were when you were growing up, what were the important acts to you? What acts did you idolize or look up to?
Depends on when.
So let's say like your formative, like early, mid, late teen years. Actually, late teen years, you're already performing yourself. So I guess early, mid teen years?
That's changed. I mean, early, when I was in junior high, I was totally into Rush.
Uh-huh.
they were the big ones.
Mm-hmm.
But then Todd started playing new records in high school. Like, we started playing together, and he got me into heavy metal and kind of, you know, he was playing me, what were the bands right then? It was like R.E.M., Dump Truck, Husker Du, The Replacements, Old U2, Elvis Costello. And those were the things that kind of made me realize that you could express something a little more personal.
Mm-hmm.
Musically. I was getting out of the Dungeons and Dragons era, kind of more into the let's read Kurt Vonnegut and get depressed.
The tortured young artiste.
Yeah, I mean there's that element of teenagedom where you just discovered intensity. You feel a need to stick with it as much as possible.
I think one of the more striking qualities of this most recent album is the songwriting. And, I would imagine people have praised you for that before. Who do you consider to be the really great songwriters, though? I mean, you mentioned, like, Costello. I'm sure he would be high on your list.
Costello is pretty up there. Mike Scott, when he's on, but...
Mike Scott?
Yeah, he wasn't last time, but hopefully he will be.
Pardon my ignorance. Who's Mike Scott?
He's in The Waterboy.
Oh, okay, sure. Yeah, Mike Scott. Okay, gotcha.
Van Morrison. Just because the thing about Van Morrison is he writes about joy better than anybody else.
Mm.
And it's so hard to write about. Like, a lot of people write about happy. You know. But he writes about joy and makes it just strong.
Mm-hmm.
It's great.
Mm-hmm.
There's the typical ones. There's Bob Dylan, there's Joni Mitchell, there's Neil Young, James Sibori, has done some amazing stuff. She just does, I don't know, there's like the middle period of James Sibori was like just lyrical tapestry. She would take the most mundane sight and turn it into an incredible poem.
When you say the middle period, what exactly are you referring to?
The Speckless Sky, like the Walking the Speckless Sky and No Borders Here.
Mm-hmm.
Musically, the production's really annoying on some of those.
Mm-hmm.
But the songwriting itself is unbelievably good.
Mm-hmm.
And I played it for friends who've had trouble getting past the production, but
mm-hmm.
the songwriting is sublime.
Mm-hmm.
It's amazing.
Mm-hmm.
Mary Margaret O'Hara is incredible.
Mm-hmm.
Bob Wiseman. I'm from Canada, so for some reason, I'm not this case. But it's not because I'm here, actually.
Okay, there's one last question here that's, one of the sort of journalist questions that has absolutely nothing to do with what we've been talking about, so please forgive me.
Okay.
This is about... the death of Kurt Cobain, and
Do you think there's a concept or an idea, sort of a common idea to people of your particular age group that, you know, the conscience of a generation has died a tragic death, or do you think of it in those grandiose terms, or is it something much more mundane?
No, I keep getting asked questions about this, and it's hard to answer.
Yeah, that's what I said. It's one of these kind of off-the-wall, you know, journalist questions that sort of doesn't really fit in with absolutely anything you're doing at all.
Yeah. I don't know. I mean, it affected everybody I knew a lot more than we thought it would.
Mm-hmm.
But, I don't know. Mostly it's just a real pity.
Yeah, well, I mean, you know, we've been talking about it, mentioning repeatedly thus far that you really don't feel that great a sense of unity with your generation, per se. So it's
I mean, I feel unity with a lot of people in my generation,
mm-hmm.
but the problem occurs when the generation is pigeonholed,
mm-hmm.
and you can't take that many millions of people and, you know, shove them into a slot, which is... You know, to some degree, the weird thing about it,
mm-hmm.
and, you know, Kurt Cobain meant a lot to an awful lot of people,
mm-hmm.
And there are people, you know, I remember being in high school, and there was a guy who, you know, we made fun of now and then, but his biggest, you know, concern was walking around asking everybody, it's like, am I a mod or a punk? What do you think I am? What should I be? I can't make up my mind. I love being a mod, but I also love being a punk, and I don't know which I should be.
Uh-huh.
And I just remember that, and how much it struck me, and how, to a degree, we all were kind of doing that. And a lot of people still do that. And, you know, the sad thing is, I, you know, so Kurt Cobain, who had been so identified with this punk ethic,
mm-hmm.
seemed like he was just starting to really get out of it,
mm-hmm.
and define himself on his own terms,
mm-hmm.
rather than saying, I'm a punk, I'm this, I'm that. Finally had a sense of humor about how his career was going, and, you know, was just going to make whatever the hell kind of music he wanted.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I looked forward to. That's, I mean, it's depressing that he didn't get to do that. Depressing he didn't get to be around for his wife and kid.
Mm-hmm.
But, I don't know. I find it hard to pigeonhole that many people. Probably I find it easy, but I don't want to.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's a bit facile. Mm-hmm. All right. Well, I'm glad we snuck that one in there. ending on a bang here. Okay. Okay, Glenn, well, it's been a pleasure, and I certainly hope the band gets a chance to come out here.
Thanks, I hope you do too. Can I ask where you're from?
I'm from, actually from the Bay Area.
Okay.
I come from Marin County.
Great.
So, I mean, you know, I was asking those questions about Santa Barbara as if I didn't know about it, but, you know, the things we do for our job.
Hey.
Yeah, but I've been out here a long time, though, so, you know, it's, This is my occupation. Is there any talk of a tour?
Yeah, we're heading out on the 7th, on the 13th of June in the state.
Mm-hmm.
But, and we're eventually going to make it to Japan, but I have no idea when at this point.
And that would be the first time?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Great. Well, like I said, get a hold of this, This handy dandy lyrical book here that CBS Records is putting out here.
Yeah, I'll ask him to send us one.
I think you'll get a kick out of it. Yeah, yeah. All right, Glenn. Well, anyway, thanks a lot, and I wish you the best of luck.
Thank you.
Okay.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Okay. They say you guys are from Santa Barbara, which is a rather unfamiliar name to the Japanese audience. What sort of a town is that?
It's about 100 miles. Such a weird echo. Strange.
Yeah, sorry, this is the way I've got this thing set up here.
Okay.
Yeah.
But it's a town about 100 miles or so north of Los Angeles.
Mm-hmm.
And it's, I don't know, a strange little place, kind of quiet college town, about 80,000 people. guess there's one part of town is kind of old money Beverly Hills style,
mm-hmm.
and the other part's the college town. And,
mm-hmm.
There's just a lot of kind of research places there. Randy and I's fathers both worked at the university. Dean and Todd's were both kind of, you know, Todd's was involved in engineering local town stuff.
Mm-hmm. Sort of a laid-back place, not the kind of town we associate with sort of a high-tension music scene, though.
No, it's not high-tension, but they just got together after school and started playing.
You weren't necessarily the musical geeks at school or the musical heroes at school or anything, were you?
We were geeks, but I don't think it had anything to do with music.
Uh-huh. Just geeks getting together to play, huh?
Just playing geeks.
Were you already fairly experienced by that time, or had you just gotten into music, or what was the situation?
I think for all of us it was kind of, well, I owned a guitar, and I'd taken lessons, but I always stopped. I mean, Dean was probably the only one, he'd like taken piano lessons seriously for 7 years.
Mm-hmm.
He was the only one who had any real ability. Todd had gone to a guitar teacher and he'd learn a couple of Boston solos. Stairway to Heaven.
Uh-huh.
So, we weren't very proficient.
Uh-huh. When did you first start taking on the veneer of professional musicians, and when did it start coming together?
About 10 years from now, I think.
No, but when were you first able to put together a demo that you felt confident people could listen to without sort of squirming in their seats?
Well, we never really did a demo, per se. I mean, our first album was probably what most people would have called their demo.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we did four-track stuff at home, and a friend of ours wanted a backup band on two songs, and
mm-hmm.
said if we'd be his backup band for two songs, he'd pay for us to record a couple, which we thought sounded good. So we just kind of went in and did those two and had a good enough time that we borrowed like $600 from my dad and recorded 8 more. And just, I mean, we were still all, you know, still all in school, so none of our friends could go to clubs and see us play. And we wanted a tape to give to them, and so we put together Bread and Circus and sold that around town.
Mm-hmm.
To our friends. And at some point it just found its way, like, people gave it to people, ended up in L.A., and
mm-hmm.
we'd never actually mailed out, like, sent a tape to a record company,
mm-hmm.
and we started getting calls back.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, it was weird, because we hadn't really planned on... I didn't ever assume that we were good enough to do this for a living.
Mm-hmm.
So when it ended up that we were getting a record deal, we were all kind of surprised.
Mm-hmm.
And by the time that happened, we were working on a second tape, and so they ended up releasing both of those as our first two albums,
mm-hmm.
as they were,
mm-hmm.
Screwing with them at all.
Huh. So they almost sort of triggered a bidding war, huh?
No, because it never got to bidding.
Uh-huh.
We had some pretty simple demands, and luckily ended up with a manager who was interested in having a career rather than making a fast buck. Because,
mm-hmm.
you know, people would throw a lot of money at it. And what we were after was being able to release the first two albums and tour on them and have creative control. And we really wanted to just have low pressure.
Mm-hmm.
I think it happens a lot that people get signed, they take a lot of money, and like, they have to be big. Doesn't matter if it's a lot of music. I mean, I think that's probably why there is, because people are allowed to do whatever they want.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So you'll see, I mean, there's a great blues scene, a great bluegrass scene, and you know, tons of rock bands.
Mm-hmm.
Really supportive. I think in Los Angeles there's a lot more of a competitive vibe going on. And
mm-hmm.
when you go see a show in Santa Barbara, just all the bands turn up for each other's shows.
Uh-huh.
I don't know, it's really supportive.
I don't think I can recall ever having heard of a band that came from Santa Barbara per se, though.
Strawberry Alarm Clock.
Okay, I think you just answered my question.
Joe.
Next question here is about how you guys originally got together. What was the bonding factor?
It was basically just something to do after school. We were all in high school, and I just kind of, the rest of them had known each other for a while, and I met them when I was a freshman, they were seniors. Just kind of did the, oh, you got a guitar? Yeah. Got drums? Yeah. Let's jam.
Mm-hmm.
So,